Still, some people join you. In the meanwhile, I will share the Can you also see that I'm sharing, everyone? Is the screen visible to you?
No, sir. It's not visible. Okay, it's visible.
Is it?
Yes, sir.
It is visible? Okay, cool. So any doubts regarding
Sir, your voice is lagging. Oh, your video is lagging too.
Okay. Is my voice better? Hello.
Yes, sir.
Is my voice better now?
Yes, sir. Or...
So what we can do is, I think.
Sir, it's still lagging.
So.
Sir, you're not audible. Okay, it's gone.
Hello. Am I audible? Hello. Am I audible?
No, sir, your voice is cutting off, so I can't understand what you're saying. Hello, sir.
Hello, is it better, Reva and Rehab?
No, sir. It also shows that your network bandwidth is low.
How about without the video? I think there is some.
Right now it's okay, but then it goes lagging afterwards.
Okay, so let me do one thing. Let's proceed with the voice for now, okay?
Okay, sir.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so Reba and Rehab, any doubts regarding last class? Let me share the screen. Any doubts regarding the last class? Can you all see the screen that I'm sharing?
Yeah.
It's visible, right? Okay. So any doubts? We just finished diencephalon, right? हेलो एम आई ऑडिबल एटलीस्ट आई ऑडिबल जस्ट कीप ओके सो इफ आई एम नॉट एबल टू ज्वाइन थ्रू वीडियो बिकॉज इट्स लैगिंग सो प्लीज कीप डिस्कसिंग सो दैट आई नो दैट आई एम स्टिल इन द लूप विद यू ओके So in last class we finished diencephalon. So today we have to start with the hindbrain. Okay, so this was the part of the midbrain. We first finished the forebrain, and then today we have to finish the midbrain and the hindbrain. Okay, so first write about the midbrain. I did tell you. So this is yes. Okay, let's first come to the cerebellum. Okay, everyone. The first part, it's the major part on which questions come. So let me first start with the cerebellum. Okay. So are you clear about the progression of the brain? So we started from cerebrum, and as I told you, in the cerebrum, the outer part is the gray matter, and the inner part is the white matter. Correct?
Yes, sir.
And you understood why it's called gray and white. Then we went on to the functions of it, and we realized that the cell body is present towards the top, and the axons are coming downwards towards the center of the brain. That's why when we reached thalamus, we realized that thalamus was a relaying link between the lower structures of the brain and the highermost, the cortex of the brain. And we also studied thalamus. Now we are going even low towards the posterior end, the dorsal and the posterior end of the brain, which is the cerebellum. So I showed you the position of cerebellum. It's somewhere here. Do you see this? So this is cerebellum below the occipital, posterior to the occipital. Is it clear?
Yeah.
Okay. But it's a very important. So write down cerebellum. First you have to write about cerebellum is. So even in the diagrams, when I drew cerebellum, I first showed you that it has a very convoluted surface. Right?
Yes.
You know that in the brain, I told you that the cells of nervous system are called neurons. But my question to you is the whole brain made up of neurons only? What do you think? Is everything that we see in the brain or the structure of brain, is it all neurons?
No.
Then what it could be? What do you think is present in the brain apart from neurons? So in the brain, there are basically the neurons are the processing cells, the fundamental units of nervous system is called neuron. But apart from neurons, we also have cells called glia. Is it clear?
Yes.
So neurons do the function, and glia, it does not do the conduction part, or it's not like a neuron, but to support the glia, to support the neurons, we have a whole different type of tissue called glia. Just like, so I use this analogy to make students understand this concept. So think of a railway system, okay? So what all things are present in a railway system? Have you traveled through railways, any country's railway, especially like Indian railways or any railways or metro?
Yes, the metro.
Metro, right? So in a metro, what you actually use for the transportation from one place to another is that train, right? That 6 or the 7 compartments train. Okay, so that train moves, that is the most functional part of the whole system. But apart from the train, we have railway tracks, we have rails, we have stations, we have subways. Everything is a part of that metro network, correct? Correct. But what moves from one place to another, or what is the functional unit? The rails. But the rails cannot process without having this elaborate network of support. Similarly, the functional part of the brain, the processing part, or which transports the, or which conducts the potential, are neurons. But these neurons need support. Support in the form of nutrition, maintenance, repair, etc. Right? And they are all provided by this glia, the tissue, apart from neurons. So these two together form brain or nervous system. Is it clear, everyone?
Yes.
Now, cerebellum has a very convoluted surface. Even in the diagram, if you'll see where I have made cerebellum, here. So I have made structure like this, right? These are called convolutions. And it is convoluted because it's very interesting that more around, approximately around 70 to 80% of all the neurons which are present in the brain is present in the cerebellum. Is it clear?
Yes.
But it is not the biggest structure of the brain. Am I correct?
Yes.
Which is the biggest structure? Biggest part of the brain. Cerebellum is a part of hind brain. Okay. So we have forebrain, midbrain, and hind brain. I told you that forebrain is the biggest, correct? And even in that forebrain, I told you that the which one? Cerebrum. Remember cerebrum?
Yes.
Cerebro. We did this discussion yesterday. Cerebrum is the biggest part. It has two hemispheres, left and right hemisphere. So if it is the biggest part, still it has very less neurons, then of course most of those cells are not neurons but are glia, correct?
Yes.
And if around 70 to 80% of neurons are present in cerebellum, it clearly means that cerebellum has very less glia and very a lot of neurons, right?
Yes, sir.
Yes. So this is where it becomes a very important organ. From this perspective, it becomes a very important organ because cerebellum, first of all, it has a convoluted surface because more and more neurons can accommodate. So because of this convoluted surface, it can accommodate around 70 to 80% of total neurons in the brain. Okay, of brain, like total of the brain. So why do we need all these neurons? Of course, to do something very important, right? So write down. Cerebellum, write down about cerebellum. Cerebellum is important to control all the functions or all the activities. All the functions or all the activities related to balancing or precision. You know what is balancing and what is precision? What are all the activities that requires balancing? Anyone can give me an example? Where do we need balancing?
Yes. when we're riding a cycle without support?
Yes. Even before riding the cycle, when a human baby is born, we say that the brain is not developed properly, correct?
Yes.
So for a human baby, it takes around the first 4 years of life are very crucial for overall development and growth of all the regions of brain. That's why a human baby at birth cannot speak, cannot understand or make languages. Okay, it cannot, because the speech center, which is in the cerebrum, is not developed. It also cannot hear and understand everything. It can, of course, react to sounds. It can also start understanding the sound of, which is the sound of the mother, which is the sound of the father. But what are they saying, it will not be able to understand, right? Or relate to. So also, what can a baby not do just after the birth? Can a baby stand up?
No, sir.
Why? Why can't the baby stand up? So does the baby does not have bones and muscles in the leg?
And the bones are not strong enough yet.
No, it's not only about the bones.
He has not learned to walk. His brain does not know how to walk.
No, it's, yes. So it's not only about the bones and the muscles and their strength. Okay. If you see animals' babies, like the baby of a deer, the baby of a deer, which is born in a wild jungle, like minutes after the birth, it can run, right? Because it has to be running to protect itself from predators, correct?
Yes, sir.
So do you think that human babies are not born with proper muscles or bones? Yes, it's true that they are not as strong as an adult, but a major reason is also that the brain is not developed properly. The cerebellum is not developed properly. Even when you see that the baby can stand up, when they start walking at around the age of 1 year or so, when they start standing up, they fall, right?
Yes.
It feels like they are not able to balance themselves. So their bones are clearly strong enough to hold them straight, but they are just like, they feel like they are disbalanced and they fall, correct?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So what happens is, it takes time for the cerebellum to develop and to make the person do all the balancing acts. For example, standing erect. So standing erect is an act of balancing, which the baby has to learn over time as the brain progresses and develops. Also walking. Walking requires lots of balancing and precision, because it just looks like simple because we have been walking for like decades now. But when we were babies, someone teaches us to walk and it requires daily practice so that we can develop that sense of balancing. The same thing happens, which you were talking about, riding a bicycle, right? We can walk, but we cannot ride a bicycle right from the birth. Because when we ride bicycle, what we learn is to balance the weight first on the right pedal and then on the left pedal, and simultaneously holding the handle, correct? Is it correct?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So riding a bicycle, standing erect, walking, all of these activities are only possible because of a developed cerebellum in our brain. Is it clear? Also, all these activities also require complex motor functions. So it's not like just the reflex. So if the baby touches something hot, or if the baby is pricked by a thorn, the baby will show the reflex, like it will retract the hand, correct?
Yes, sir.
Because that's not a very complex motor function. You just have to retract the hand. So there is a motor function, but not complex one. But when you are writing, when you are walking, when you are riding a bicycle, when you are painting, or like when you are playing a guitar, it requires complex motor functions, which are very much coordinated and controlled. Am I right? So
yes,
all these complex motor functions are carried out by cerebellum. So write down, complex motor functions are possible because of cerebellum. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay, very good. Now, the word cerebellum itself, what does the word cerebellum means? So write down, the word cerebellum itself means a little brain. It's the Latin word. The cerebellum is a Latin word which means little brain. So it looks, or in evolution, it feels like many organisms, so almost all organisms that have a brain or the concept of brain, can do certain things like basic nervous or neuronal processing. But organisms that have developed cerebellum, okay, so the first kind of cerebellum you find is in organisms which are a kind of fish. So it's very clear that it's only a feature of vertebrates, right? Invertebrates do not have a cerebellum as per se. Is it clear, everyone?
Yes, sir.
So it's the concept which evolved in vertebrates, like from the fish, and till humans have the most evolved cerebellum. So it's in itself, it's like a little brain. So we have a kind of two brain, one brain that processes everything that other organisms can also process, and the other brain which makes us very versatile. We are painters, dancers. Have you seen gymnasts and dancers? They have so much of control on every muscle of their body, right? So they can actually make every muscle of their body move according to their will sometimes. Correct?
Yes, sir.
This is because they have a cerebellum which they can train. And the more you train your cerebellum to do complex motor activities, the more complex kind of motion you can show. So write down.
Yes, sir.
The cerebellum, basically cerebellum does not, so I'm not saying that it initiates movement. To start a movement, you don't need cerebellum. And what is the proof of it? Because invertebrates, all the animals which do not have a vertebral column, all the invertebrates do move, right? Ants, cockroach, all these also move, right? Even without a cerebellum. So to move, we do not need cerebellum. But to make coordinated, precise, accurate timing movements, we need cerebellum. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Do you understand the difference between the two?
Yes.
Is the difference clear? Okay, so write down. Cerebellum does not initiate movement. Cerebellum does not initiate movement, but is important for coordination. But is important for coordination, precision, and accurate timing. Coordination, precision, and accurate timing. So if I ask you, and which is a question which comes sometimes, is asked also in boards, I have seen. So if a human or anyone has a cerebellar damage, so the cerebellum is damaged, then what do you think will happen? What kind of disorders or problems the person will show? Anyone? So will the person be paralyzed?
Maybe I can lose a coordination.
Yes, but the person will not be paralyzed, because to show movement, the cerebellum is not required. You can still move. Cockroaches can move. They can go everywhere without a cerebellum. Earthworms can move, right? So what will happen is, the person will not paralyze, but will lose finer movements. Like the person may no longer be able to do a Bharatnatyam for that matter, or will not be able to do balance on a bicycle, will not be able to ride a bicycle. But the person will be able to walk, but that walking may be a little disordered. Do you understand? And you cannot teach that person any kind of motor learning, like to write properly. So if you see a person who can hold a pen but cannot write properly, maybe the problem is in the cerebellum. Is it clear? So these people, when they are moving, when they are doing anything, they cannot do it with great precision, but they can do, they can move, they are not paralyzed. So write down cerebellar damage. Cerebellar damage affects four things. First is fine movement. Cerebellar damage affects, I'll write it here, cerebellar damage affects fine movements. It also affects your posture. So they cannot stand, they can stand erect, but they cannot stand without moving very precisely in an attention position. Do you understand the difference? So if you ask them to stand in an attention position, do you understand? Am I audible? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So there'll be a problem in the posture. And also, along with this, there'll be a problem in motor learning. Like learning how to play guitar, piano, violin, ride a bicycle, drive a car, etc. So the motor learning is reduced or not proper. Okay.
Yes.
Okay, so this is about the importance of cerebellum. Now, apart from cerebellum, what other things we have in the hind brain? We have one thing called pons. Remember pons, medulla, and cerebellum. These are the three parts in the hind brain. Correct? So what is pons? When I was teaching you respiratory system, remember I told you about the respiratory center? Where was that respiratory center present? Anyone remember? Okay, what does pons mean? Yes, right. So all our centers, important involuntary centers, are either present in the pons or the medullary region. Okay, so what does pons means basically through language? So I talk about terminology. So in terminology, what does pons mean? So pons means bridge. It's a Latin word for bridge. What does a bridge do? What is the function of a bridge? Any idea what does bridge do?
Helps cross.
Helps? Bridge connects, right? It connects two ends. Any two ends which were not connectable or were separated, it connects. Okay? And pons is a part of brainstem. Remember I told you pons, medulla, and the... And what? And the midbrain, they form a part of brain stem. Okay?
Yes.
Okay. Now write down a few functions which are asked about the pons. So So if I tell you it's a bridge, the first function already is that it relays signal. First important function is it relays signal from the forebrain to the cerebellum. From the forebrain to cerebellum. So it relays the signal because it's a bridge between the forebrain. So all the motor signals to do something is coming from the forebrain. And if it is about the fine motor things that have to be controlled, then it has to go to the cerebellum from where it can control things, right? Okay. And second thing is it has certain centers, control centers. I told you about one center when I was teaching you a respiratory system, which was called pneumotaxis center. Remember anyone? Pneumotaxis center. Is it clear? Pneumotaxis center. So this pneumotaxis center is present in pons. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
And this center, what does it controls? It regulates inhalation and exhalation. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Inhalation and exhalation. And very specifically what it does is, have you ever thought, so when you exhale forcefully, then automatically you inhale back, right? Because there is a less pressure in your lungs and it needs to be full, it needs to be filled. So air rushes into your lungs the moment you, so inhalation is understandable, right? But has it also happened if you try, so inhale, take a deep breath and then close your nose and block your exhalation. Do not allow yourself to exhale. So do you feel that there is an urge of exhalation also? Our body needs, feels like we have to exhale also. You start feeling uncomfortable, correct? Is it yeah. correct? But that, and this thing can be trained. Do you know deep sea divers or when you learn swimming or diving, they tell you to take a deep breath, go into the water and stay submerged for as long as you can and then come out and exhale, correct? So this is the yes. training that they do. Now, biologically, it is okay to feel uncomfortable when you have exhaled and you are not inhaling because the body needs oxygen, so you have to inhale. But when you inhale properly and when you inhale very deep, then why do you want to exhale very, very fast? Or like, why can't you hold it? Why do you start feeling uncomfortable? You have a lot of oxygen and all that can still get exchanged. But this urge, this conversion or change from inhalation to exhalation is done by this pneumotaxis center. Is it clear? So this pneumotaxis center makes sure that if you are inhaling, you also exhale. And when you will exhale, again, you will inhale and then again exhale. So this rhythm has to keep on going. Okay?
Yes, sir.
So, and some functions, some high-end function of pons, which are still under research, which is, I think, is not in NCRT, is that pons is also, it's implicated or it's shown to have an effect in something called, write down pons is, or pons plays a role in sleep paralysis. You know what is a sleep paralysis? When a person is in under immense stress sometimes, then it happens that during when the person is asleep, suddenly the person opens eyes and becomes conscious, but the brain still cannot control the whole part of the body and it stays unconscious. So you open your eyes, you can see the environment, but you cannot control it. And then you get afraid and you cannot control your own body because the brain is still half asleep. That is called a paralysis-like condition during the sleep. It's called sleep paralysis. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
It's one of the side effects or symptoms of very stressful regime. If a person is very stressed or like anxious or depressed, it can happen. And also, pons is found to play some role in generating dreams. Now, these two functions are not very clear how it functions, like the mechanism is not clear, but it is there. It is important for these functions. Okay. So we have pons and we have cerebellum. And apart from this, what do we have in the hindbrain? We have medulla oblongata, right?
Yes, sir.
So the last part of the hindbrain, the brain, is your medulla. The complete name is medulla oblongata. Okay. So it is the lowest part of the brain. Okay. Even the lowest part of the brain stem. So it's present the lowest. So lowest part of brain, starting from the top, which is the cortex. If you keep on going low, the lowest part is the medulla. And I've also drawn it here. If you see, I have drawn a brain stem. So see here, from this part, the spinal cord starts. Okay. So this lowest part is the medulla oblongata. Is it clear? Okay, this part here. So if any signal is going through the spinal cord into the brain, then which is the first part it will encounter of the brain? Tell me, do you understand the question? My question is that a signal is going through the spinal cord into the brain. So which is the first part of the brain that the signal will encounter or meet? Hello, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Do you understand my question? See, this is medulla. This part here is medulla, the lowest part of the brain. And this is spinal cord. So if a signal is going through the spinal cord into the brain, then the first part it will encounter is medulla, correct?
Yes.
So that's why the first major function of medulla becomes, it plays a, write down the first function of medulla. It plays a critical role. It plays a critical role in transmitting signals between the spinal cord and higher parts of the brain. Is it clear, everyone?
Yes, sir.
Because it's simple. You don't have to mug it up. You don't have to memorize it if you understand the brain and the structure itself. So if I go back to that figure, look here. This is the most top part, the most anterior part of the brain, which has lots and lots of cell bodies where all the processing happens. But if any signal is coming through the spinal cord, it is coming from the down and going up into the brain, right? So clearly, the top parts of the brain, as I also told you, the cerebrum, is important for speaking, motor activity, thoughts, perception, processing, auditory, visual. Everything, every processing of every sensory organ is happening in the cortex. Is it clear, everyone? As we come down, the processing part decreases a bit and the regulation starts. So thalamus connects as a link. Hypothalamus is a link between endocrine and ANS. It regulates body temperature, thirst, hunger, pituitary gland, emotional behavior, and sleep-wake rhythm. If we go more down, which is cerebellum, then we found that it is present in balancing, precision, and the damage affects the fine movements, posture, and learning. If we go even down, the pons, it relays again, because it is at the bottom. So it is getting the signal and relaying it from to the upper, like from forebrain to cerebellum, and also vice versa. It also has a pneumotaxic center, which helps in regulation of inhalation and exhalation. And it also plays a role in sleep paralysis and generating dreams. So both of them are not very intellectual functions, right? They does not require processing or thinking. Medulla oblongata is the lowest part of the brain, which makes it very logical to understand that it plays a very critical role in transmitting the signals from the spinal cord to the higher parts of the brain. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Because any signal that will enter the brain from spinal cord will first meet the medulla oblongata. So that's where the logic comes. So if you understand the logic of the structure and anatomy of the brain, you don't have to mug up things. You don't have to remember a lot of facts. Any doubts?
No.
Okay. Write down about medulla oblongata. Write down a few points. The medulla contains, and apart from playing a critical role in transmitting signals from one part, from the lower part to higher, or from the spinal cord to the higher part, it also, like pons, pons has a pneumotaxic center. It also has many centers. Write down, medulla contains cardiac, respiratory, vomiting, also which is known as nausea, vomiting, and vasomotor centers. All these centers are present in medulla. Yes. Okay. Is it clear, everyone?
Yes.
Yeah. So if all these centers are present in medulla, then it is important for a lot of involuntary, because see, the cardiac function is involuntary. We cannot control our cardiac input or output. Respiratory center is also involuntary. Vomiting, you cannot control it. Once the nauseating effect has started, you cannot control it. You have to vomit if you feel nauseated, okay? And these centers, because they are reflex centers, also write down, along with vomiting, reflex centers for coughing, sneezing. So once you feel like sneezing, can you control the sneezing? Has it happened to you sometimes that you feel like you will sneeze, but the sneeze doesn't come out?
Yes.
And you feel like, okay, it's gone, but just within few seconds, you sneeze very loud.
Yes.
Has it happened to you?
Yes.
So this sneeze center is also in the medulla. And apart from sneeze center, also the swallow center. Swallowing is also a reflex sometimes. So if something goes very deep into the throat, we end up swallowing it, even if we don't want to swallow it. Like sometimes small kids by mistake swallow a marble or a small coin or something like that, right? Accidentally. So that is done by your medulla. Anything else I need to tell you? Okay, so this is about medulla. So we have finished. Hindbrain, pons, cerebellum, medulla. We have finished cerebrum, thalamus, hypothalamus from the forebrain. Also write down few things about midbrain. In the end, I'm just teaching about the midbrain because the midbrain, a lot of function of midbrain is not very elaborately understood or explored like scientifically. And it is the least asked in the entrances, but write down a few points. The midbrain is located between, I have drawn here the midbrain. If I show you, look here. Can you see this box kind of structure? This one? Hello? Can you see this? Yes. So midbrain is located between, it's a small part. It's different from both forebrain and hindbrain. That's why it's given the name midbrain. And I told you that it contains tectum and tegmentum, right? You wrote tectum and tegmentum? Yes. So write down, it's located between the thalamus of forebrain. It's located between thalamus of forebrain and pons of hindbrain. So between the thalamus and pons, your midbrain is there. And one thing that we know about the midbrain is that there is a canal, a vascular system, like a canal like system, like a pipe like system, which is called it's called cerebral aqueduct. Okay, so this passes through the midbrain. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. And apart from that, I don't think much is important from midbrain part. Okay, so I don't think I have to cover anything else from the midbrain. Okay, now all of you, do you have NCRT with you right now, everyone?
Yes, sir.
Do people have NCRT with you? So I wanted to explain one figure. So I was checking NCRT today and I realized that there is a figure for a knee-jerk reflex in NCRT. Let me see if I can paste that figure here. Can you see this figure here? I'm sharing NCRT. Is it visible to you all? No.
No, sir.
Okay. One minute.
I can see it in my textbook.
Okay. Let me paste it here. Now, is it visible to you, the figure, everyone?
Yes, sir.
Let me make it big. Here, is it clear now?
Yes.
Yes. So this is what I was asking you to go and check on internet or anywhere. So this is something we were talking about yesterday, and something I wanted to explain in this figure is, so do you see these two muscles? Thigh muscles. These are the big thigh muscles. Let me use red here. So this muscle here, which I'm marking, and this muscle here. You see this? The bigger muscles. And with the help of this kind of a structure, so this is the kneecap. So on our knee, you all can feel that your knee has a kneecap, a very roundish or triangular bone, the center of your knee, that protect, basically this kneecap protects this joint. So you see, there is a joint, these two bones. So this is the femur bone and this is your leg bone. So between the joint, this is the kneecap. So anything that has to affect this joint has to first hit on the kneecap. When you fall on your kneecap so that your joints are protected. So if you hit somewhere just below the kneecap on this area, which I'm marking here. So it somewhere activates the receptors. It sends a signal through the afferent pathway of this muscle, because there is a tendon connecting to this. And this efferent muscle, or the receptor which is here, this receptor gets activated and it sends a signal all the way to the gray matter of the spinal cord. And when I say gray matter, again, what do I mean by gray matter? Just like brain has a gray matter, spinal cord's gray matter means what is present here? Cell bodies. Clear? All the cell bodies are present in the gray matter. And because nissl granules are present in these cell bodies, that's why they look gray. Clear?
Yes.
And outside of the gray matter is the white matter. So if you see a spinal cord structure, this is what I wanted to tell you. It comes in entrances. In a spinal cord, the inner part has the gray matter and the outer part has the white matter. So the neuron is arranged like this. This is the cell body and this is the axon. This is the arrangement. Is it clear? Whereas in a brain, it's opposite. In a brain, the outer part has the cell body or the gray matter and the inner part has the axons, right? Or the white matter. Is it clear?
Yes.
Okay. So this goes to the gray matter and then there is an interneuron, this neuron that you are seeing here. This is the interneuron. And then there is a motor neuron that carries it all the way to the motor end plate. So signal starts from the upper muscle and ends, the motor signal ends in the lower muscle, which actually makes this part of the leg in response to this tapping go up. Like you throw the leg, there is a jerk kind of reflex. Is it clear? So an afferent pathway, which brings it towards the gray matter, and an efferent pathway that takes it to the motor end plate or the effector organ. So I wanted to show you this arrangement of gray matter and white matter in a spinal cord. So this is a spinal cord. Is it clear, everyone?
Yes.
From here to here. Do you understand what is the difference? So inner part has the cell bodies and outer part has the axons, which is opposite to the brain. Clear? Any doubts? Any doubts, anyone? Okay, so if you have no doubts, in the next class, I will start with action potential, for which I'm giving you a homework. So in the next class, we will start action potential generation. Remember, we started ECG?
Yes.
Okay, so this is somewhere I will draw parallels to ECG. So first thing that you have to do is you have to revise ECG and come for your next class, which is on Wednesday. So revise ECG, which is from the cardiac system. Okay, cardiovascular system. And second thing, please go and if you you revise potential from physics or chemistry, it comes in your physics and chemistry, potential, voltage, current. Will you do this? You have to revise these few things because before you come in the next class. Okay, this is your take assignment. Clear, everyone?
Yes.
Okay, just note it down and then we'll meet in the next class. Take care.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, bye-bye. See you. Rehab, are you done noting? Are you still noting? Rehab, can you hear? Are you there?